was here right now, you know what he would say? Ain't no need to worry with the night. I just want to pray. It'll be all over in the morning. In the
okay. stop. It's something about that name. A shifter in my atmosphere. Something about that name, Jesus. Oh, how precious. Oh, how precious. Yeah, I know that was a little different. You know, normally we get off into that crying mode and, you know. But God want to do something different as normal. And he wants to open us up to a place of appreciation. I can't front when I'm crying. I'm feeling real good, but every now and then I got a sad thought on my mind, or something that I'm missing on my mind, or something that I think I should have had or should have done on my mind. But it's something about when I got an appreciation just for the name of Jesus, I don't need nothing else. Mm-hmm. So I don't have to worry about a tear falling. I don't have to worry about who ain't calling. I ain't gotta worry about my lack, my misunderstanding, my misfire, what I'm missing. Because whatever it is that I need, there's a name I can call on that will give me exceedingly abundantly above all.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
That I can ask for a match.
Say that.
We talking about Jesus. You know, I don't know where your appreciation level is right now. But the Lord says, I'm going to escalate your appreciation level. I want you to understand something. When you go to the mall and you need to get to the second floor, you don't take the steps. You get on the escalator. Because it's going to make you rise a little bit faster. This is what the Lord is speaking in your life in accordance to your appreciation, that I'm going to make you rise a little bit faster. Oh, and it ain't going to take as much effort to do it. Come on and feel me in this. An escalator. There's an escalator rolling in your faith. I'm going to make you rise a little bit higher to get to the next level to do what you need to do. But it ain't gonna take as much. It ain't what I don't have that's keeping me from getting there. It's the fact that I won't acknowledge what I do have that's gonna take me there. I hope you didn't miss that. It ain't what I'm missing in life that kept me from getting there. It ain't my faults. It ain't my ain't gots. It ain't my doubts. It's the fact that I won't acknowledge, I won't appreciate what I do have that's going to take me there. It ain't that you're going to make it there on your own. The escalator's doing the work for you. Why won't you call on your escalator?
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, bless you, Jesus. Bless you.
I'm sorry. You don't get on an escalator and begin to walk.
Bless you, Lord. Of course. Thank you.
The Lord is speaking in a whole new tone today. And he wants us to understand that we've been trying to do too much in our own strength when all we had to do was acknowledge. And this word is going to be real key today. All we had to do was acknowledge what we did have. All the resources that are needed in order to get to the next place to do the next thing are already in place. The problem is we won't acknowledge them. How about that? We won't acknowledge him.
Jesus. Jesus.
They say fear and doubt is a thief of your possibilities. But honestly, it's not a thief. It's just an accepting recipient of what you were willing to give away. Trying to hold on and do too much. So I speak to you today. Don't be afraid to get on the escalator. It's there for a reason. Don't be afraid to get on Jesus. He's there for a reason. Don't be afraid to latch on. Hold on. See, when you're young and you ain't quite sure your foot, and you get on the escalator, you grab a hold of that little rubber piece as it rolls up, and you let it brace you. Why won't you let Jesus brace you? I want you to understand this particular analogy that I'm giving you because, you know, after a while we get on the escalator and it's like, oh, this ain't nothing. And sometimes we get on it and it's like, it's moving too slow. And you want to jump a few steps. And then when you get to the top, you trip. Tell you a little story. Good at these stories, you know. Lord, give me these things. All these experiences that I had that were just so embarrassing to me back in the day, they happened for a reason. Remember, I told you, everything you need is already in place. The resources were already there, but the problem is, you know, we won't acknowledge them. And many times our downfalls, our failures, the embarrassing moments are resources. So let me give you one. I was about 8 years old. I'm at the mall out at Northwest Plaza, JCPenney. Used to be my grandmama's favorite store. Used to go out there for the President's Day white sale. Granddaddy sitting there and he just a grumbling and a mumbling, and you knew he was mad because he didn't want to be there because all he said was, And she running them around the store, and you know, the tiles was on the second floor. We would always park downstairs because that would give her a chance to go through the men's section and pick him something out for church. So he wouldn't so loud. And they get me on the escalator, and you know, I'm goofing off because escalator ain't nothing to me about this time. It's winter time, and you know, the fashion back then was the moon boot. I don't know if y'all remember them the Martian looking boots that was kind of plastic but somewhat rubber, but they was funny looking. You know, the women wear they call them heels now. I think they call them wedges, but if they was plastic at the bottom and had the big bubble front. Well, Betty, remember when the women wear them Herman Monster shoes? They was like moon boots. They was Herman Monster boots. So I'm on this escalator and I'm playing. And I'm trying to go up the doggone steps of the escalator really, really fast. And you know when you get to the top of the escalator, the step collapses. Well, it collapsed on my moon boot, and I heard something go, pow! My moon boot exploded. And you might think, what in the world is this lesson? What does this story have to do with anything? Sometimes you're going up and things get so easy to you, they become so routine to you, that you get ahead of yourself. You get ahead of the process, you get ahead of the escalator. And when the step collapses because you're coming back down to earth, something blows up, trips you up. You fall, you fail, you run into an embarrassing situation. And in the process of running into that embarrassing situation, your resource will correct it. What are you talking about? Well, Jesus is my source, but grandmama was my only vision of Jesus that I really saw at that time. Baby, let's go to the shoe aisle and get you something. Granddaddy is mumbling under his breath, and you know, he was saying some really obscene things under his breath. You can kind of tell because his lips start moving a little bit. Because he was mad. He didn't want to be there in the first place. But her coming into an understanding, her coming into a compassion, her seeing a need, got me out of the moon boots. Could have walked around with a blown tire around the mall embarrassed. But she ain't let me. How many times have we got ahead of ourselves? Blew out that shoe. Tripped up in front of everybody. But something as precious as the name of Jesus, as the presence of Jesus, as the person of Jesus, soften the blow. Showed up as a resource when we didn't have one. I say that to you because, again, we're on the subject of agreement. And the one thing that I understand in agreement is that you can't do it by yourself. I'm gonna say that one again. In dealing with the law of agreement, in dealing with the principle of agreement, I want you to catch this because it is a law. So every time that God's law comes into play, it has to come forth. Oh, and a law is built, we're gonna get into that later. But in dealing with that, it has to be more than one. You can't agree just with you. Ain't no power in just you. Well, there is, but without him, your source. So even with that, you still have to have more than one. I'm saying this to you because many times in our lives, we come into a place where we're in agreement with us. Nothing more. If somebody want to jump on the bandwagon, they're allowed to jump on the bandwagon. But let them come into a disagreement with us, and it's still back to one. The purpose of it was never to join into alignment. It was me, myself, and I. So I put this exhortation in front of you as a prelude to what you're going to get today. We're going to be on agreement for a while. Because until we can get this principle in our spirits, love is impossible. Going back to a sermon on love, we said that love cannot exist in rivalry. Rivalry means I'm looking out for me, myself, and I. Love works in the power of agreement. So, if indeed God is love, how can we work with God? How can God work in us if we won't agree? If it's only about one. Praise Him, Mama.
Father, I thank and praise you that you are just and that you are just a righteous God. I praise you and I give you glory and honor that we agree with you today. We touch and agree with you, who you say we are, all that you say that we can do, and all that you say that we can be. I thank and praise you that you take us to another level in our thinking with you, to help us to think like you think and talk like you think and walk like you walk and talk like you walk and do as you do in the earth as we touch and agree with you. You're just looking for somebody who will cooperate with you. I pray, Father, that we could even touch and agree without an ability to do it. So empower us, Father. Give us a willing spirit to align with your word and align with your thoughts and align with your thinking in the name of Jesus. I call forth the greater in us, for the greater one lives inside of us, and we pull upon your greatness, oh God. We ain't nothing without you, so we pull upon the greatness within you as we touch and agree with the greater one. I thank and praise you that you are the Holy One, that you are the righteous God, that you are the everlasting Father. I pray that you touch the depths of us that we haven't turned over to you yet, Father. Go deep within us, Father, that these gifts, these talents, and the abilities that you have placed in us will no longer hide them in a hole, Father, but expose it and make it plain, Father, and give us the courage to move forth to be everything that you have us to be. I thank and praise you for your law of agreement, that you already settled this thing in heaven. So settle this thing in our hearts and our minds, Father, in the name of Jesus. And we just forever give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. I pray the word of God does not fall upon one deaf ear in the name of the Lord Jesus. I thank and praise you for the seed of your word, for you have already sown. on it, and you said it can't come back to you the same way you sent it out. So I thank and praise you that your word is already settled in heaven, that you fix it in our hearts and fix it in our minds and fix your word in our lives, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, that it'll yield for some 30, 60, and 100-fold in Jesus' name. Amen.
Turn with me to the book of Mark, the 6th chapter. This might get good to you. This might get good to you. I start at the 4th verse. Y'all gotta excuse me with the coffee. For some strange reason. No. Spring won't play with me, so warm fluids help me right now. In the 4th verse, it speaks of Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor, except in his own home, in his own town, among his relatives, and in his own home. He could not do any miracles there, except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. He was amazed at their lack of faith." He was amazed at their lack of faith. Why I start there? Why did I start there? Well, flip with me to Matthew 18. We're just gonna kind of toggle between those two real quick. I wanna show you something in the comparison and show you how this thing works, because what I kept seeing in the Bible was, you know, everybody uses the law of agreement coming out of Acts because it showed a positive outcome. But I wanna show you what the law of disagreement will bring. Because see, a lot of times we can get happy with the good product, but until we see the bad, we don't wanna change. Until we see the negative aspect of something, we won't change. We won't hear it until it affects us. Title today's message is, "I Will Not Disagree." If I go down to the 15th verse, and I want you to catch a key word, and you'll hear it a couple of times. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault, just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen, even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. What was the key word in that? Listen. But I want you to catch it. What is a disagreement? Somebody tell me. I'm gonna play with this. We're gonna play with this scripture a little bit. What's a disagreement? Talk to me.
I ain't agreeing with you telling me.
Opposition.
Wait a minute. Say that again.
I'm not gonna agree with what you're telling me.
So for what I'm saying, you stop doing what?
Listen.
So if you're not listening, that means you will not receive. Correct? Wait a minute. Let's get into something. Let's break some things down. In the scripture, Jesus tells them, if you see your brother tripping, receive you. Receive the information you're giving them. If indeed they refuse to receive it, then you go to two or three. Wait a minute. There's power in numbers. You go to two or three. See, watch this. When I come one-on-one, you don't hear me. Maybe I come one-on-three this time. Okay, well, if you want to be bold about it and you still don't want to listen, you still don't want to receive, now I'm going to bring the masses at you. When you still fail to receive what the masses are telling you, I can't do nothing for you. I got to dismiss you. I don't stop loving you because your failure to receive is now your problem. All we were trying to do in this exchange was get you to agree. That's all Jesus was attempting to do. I'm gonna come at you one-on-one. I'm gonna send two or three at you. I'm gonna send 50 at you. If you can't hear 50 different people telling you, something ain't right here. See, sometimes, you know, we'll hear something, we just won't believe it because we think it's their perception. When you get two or three people together and it's, they was just getting together. They were collaborating. I can't hear that. But if you keep hearing the same thing about you over and over and over and over and over again, and you fail to agree with it, let me renounce that word. We ain't gonna say agree. You fail to receive it. You fail to take hold of, to take grasp of, to perceive that maybe it is me. There's nothing anybody else can do for you because you already rejected what's come at you. You only want what you want, how you want, when you want. And that's how you gonna move. It's become not about us. It's not become about kingdom. What it's become about is me, myself, and I. And normally that type of person is a victim. The world is against them. Everything that anybody's ever said about them, you're picking on me. You just don't like me. Well, some would say, okay, I feel rejected then. Rejected means that others can't receive you. There's an old saying that says, when you're looking for something, you sow it. So if you can't receive from nobody else, what makes you think that people will be able to receive from you? Now let me go into a word of agreement. Drop down in that scripture, Matthew 18. Somebody read me the 19th verse.
Again, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven.
Again, wait a minute. You wouldn't listen the first time. Again, I tell you. Again, I give you an opportunity. Again, I present a seed to you. That if any two of you, I don't need three, I don't need 19, I don't need a whole church, I need one other person, will agree. Not on some things, not on most things. How about this? On one thing. Watch this. I'm going to throw some words at you that are synonyms of agree. If any two of you will accommodate. If any two of you will acknowledge. If any two of you will adjust. If any two of you will relate. If any two of you will align. If any two of you will approve of. if any two of you will arrange. If any two of you will arbitrate. I'm going to stop right there. Because that's a good word. Arbitrate. Anybody know what arbitrate means?
That's a legal term.
Mm-hmm.
I know when my mama was in the union, they used to go into arbitration. It was like where, what I remember it being is like, if, like, and I'm taking it to her job terms, somebody on the job may have an issue and they would go to the arbitrator, that person who would agree with them and present their case before someone else so that they could join them in agreement, someone to... And I could be off, but that's
mm-hmm. yeah. Someone to negotiate. Someone that has, oh, and here's the last word, authority to authorize. See, I'm dealing in a legal term because anytime you enter into agreement with someone, it's covenant. It's promise. God moves in promise and covenant. And the answers to all of his promises and covenant are yes and amen. Agreement.
Right.
So if indeed you now can move with one another, ask anything, arbitrating with someone else. You can't arbitrate unless you have the authority to do so. Many times we don't agree because we feel like we don't have the authority.
Mm.
Many times we don't agree because we feel like they don't understand us. Nobody will be able to see where I am. Nobody understands where I'm going. Nobody can get a picture of what I need. They can't see my need, so I can't touch and agree with them because I don't trust them to do it. You have to trust an arbitrator to go before somebody else for you. When I'm without, I call on the name of Jesus, my arbitrator, who not only has the authority to do so, but will bring an affiliation with me and other men, will bring me in approval of other men in the midst of my issue, will bring forth an arrangement so that my issue can come forth. Oh, you're not understanding. See, an agreement is already saying that it's done. Many times we try to negotiate the issue with Jesus, but the problem is we disagree with the fact that he ain't handled the issue. If indeed we fail to listen to victory, if we fail to listen to the yes and the amen, if we fail to listen to the resolution. See, I want you to catch something and see, I've been going through this all week and I didn't understand why the Lord was really dealing with me. But every time I heard somebody bring forth a negative resolution to a situation that really I already saw a positive turnaround on, but they just didn't want to agree. They didn't want to, watch this, they didn't even want to touch. It wasn't the fact that they didn't agree, because had they even reached out and touched, because I want you to understand, every word that I gave you that was a synonym of agree was an action word. You can't sit back and not do something in the midst of agreement. Didn't we say that about love too? Okay, so now you see how they correlate. If indeed we're dealing with the fact that someone does not even want me to touch their issue. They're saying that I don't trust the Jesus in you. I don't trust the authority in which you're even talking to me on. And getting offended this week. Because real talk, you was disrespecting my Jesus. To hell with me. You ain't got to trust me. But trust the Jesus in me. Trust my arbitrator. I may not have a total mind of, I can see. But guess what? I'm willing to go to the other side with you. See, the only thing about that we fail to understand is when we're willing to touch with somebody, we're willing to go somewhere that we ain't at right now. Because we're authorized to do so together. Maybe I threw that over your head. Let me throw that one up for out of you. Y'all ready? To touch and agree. We ain't gonna deal with the agreement part. Let's deal with the touch part of it. When you touch, you make an action that you already consent the reaction of. When I touch in the spirit realm with you, I already see what's going to happen. I'm calling forth the action already. I'm walking with you in the action of, though you ain't there. When I can touch with you, I'm going to grab you. I'm going to come in contact with a place that you ain't comfortable with. I'm going to come in contact with a place that, it's going to invade your space. Think about it. 3 inches, 3 inches, 3 inches. You're too close. You're in my box. And many times we won't touch with anybody because we don't want them in our box. Because they can't understand us in our box. That's my safety zone. When you're willing to break your safety zone to go with somebody else because you're trying to get to the next place because you need to get on the escalator, but you don't know where it is and you need somebody to grab a hold of you and escort you like you was a baby to get there. Oh, I ain't no baby. Well, that's your fault. If you were so grown, you wouldn't be where you at. We all need somebody sometime. We all sit back. If y'all don't remember, I taught a lesson or a sermon about going back to the front of the class. When you graduate and you learned everything you needed to learn and you was in the back of the class because everybody that really needed the good stuff was at the front. There comes a time when you go to the next level where you got to go to the front of the class. When you go to the front of the class and you get that next issue that you don't know how to deal with. That you don't know how to wrap your mind around. That you can't come into one accord with what God said because you ain't heard him yet. Though he was already talking, but because this issue has distracted you. Because this issue has ticked you off. This issue keep poking you. It keep coming in contact with you. It keep touching a nerve. You won't sit back and say, you know what, let me embrace this issue. But let me grab a hold of somebody else that got some authority that I may not have or that I may have. But their job is to come in contact with me. Oh, wait a minute. The laying of hands is what? To touch somebody. Just a touch from Jesus will change you. Could it be the Jesus in the person that you were supposed to touch and agree with is going to activate something in you? But you can't even come into agreement until you allow that person in your box. Well, I can't tell my stuff to everybody. Confess your faults unto one another so that ye, not them, so that ye may be here. Well, my pastor said that I ain't supposed to tell everybody my business. Because, you know, I read Facebook and they say you be careful who you tell your business to because they're going to get you. Who's your arbitrator? Who is authorized to justify you? Who said that I will establish you? You so busy trying to keep your 3-3-3-3-3 that you missed infinite possibility. Not because you didn't agree, it's because you failed to touch. You failed to tap into what the agreement really was. We're talking about disagreeing. Why do I disagree? Scared? No, you ain't. You ain't scared. You embarrassed. That's part of fear. No, it ain't. Embarrassment is motivation for me most of the time. Because it'll make me not do something. Let me rip my pants and I promise you I ain't getting up too much. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Well, my pants is real tight and I ain't trying to go to the buffet right now. I'm scared I'm gonna bust my pants. No, you ain't. You embarrassed because you know you will. You've already touched the other side of what wasn't supposed to be agreed with. Come on. Let me say that again. See, our perception of things, we're going to go back to perception because perception is everything. Our perception is the negative thing. But how can I set my mind and press towards the higher calling? How can I think of good things when I'm always seeing the negative? So my disagreement is not with the negative portion of it. It's with what I could have. It's where I'm supposed to be. I'm not even trying to touch where I'm supposed to be. Because what I'm doing is, if this is my downfall, standing right in front of me, am I going to lean on my downfall so I can fall? Am I going to keep claiming my weaknesses? Or am I going to claim my arbitrator? See, I promise you, instead of speaking out your weaknesses, instead of speaking out your faults, maybe you need to be speaking Jesus. We claim and touch those things. We come into agreement with those things. So guess what? The law of agreement says, you shall have what you speak. The law of agreement says, guess what? Because you want it so much, because you acted on it, you didn't act on arbitration. You didn't act on your arrangement. You didn't act on the other side. You acted on what was right there. So have it. How can God take you to an escalated point if you never get on the escalator? I want to get to the second level and you just wandering around the first floor. Lost. Well, you wandering lost because guess what? The escalator door was right in front of you, and in the back of your mind, you heard that little faint thought that said, it's a possibility that it's going to take you where you need to be. But then all of a sudden, you start claiming your woulda, coulda, shoulda's. You claim your past. You claim the present that don't belong to you. You claim the future that you ain't never supposed to come in contact with. And you got exactly that. If any two touch and agree on anything, he didn't say just the good stuff. Right. Right. Oh, right. Help me, Jesus. Right. You don't believe me? Turn to Genesis, the 11th chapter. Whew. Somebody read me verses 1 through 7.
Now the whole world has one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly. They used bricks instead of stones and tar for mortar. Then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves.
Stop. Read that last portion again.
Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves.
Okay, we just heard idolatry. We just heard a whole faction of people come into agreement to build, not to tear down, not to go to war. They're doing something in man's eyes is very positive. In man's eyes. But they want to do it for their me, mine, and I. They come into agreement with one another. They're willing to even touch the other side of it. Because you can't touch something that you ain't got a vision of. Oh, then I just thought something. You can't touch something that you don't have a vision of. Grab a hold of Jesus. How can I grab a hold of something that I can't envision? How can I grab a hold of something that I don't know? I don't know where to grab a hold of. Well, Pastor, you, how? Well, let me help you. If indeed you don't have any inkling of who Jesus is, you don't have an inkling of when his presence is around you, if you don't have an inkling of his authority or his power, how can you grab a hold of it? If you don't have an inkling of what he represents, how can you grab a hold of it? You can't agree with nothing in this world until you got a vision of it. That's why the negative portions of what we deal with, see, when we get that negative thoughts, see, the world tell you negative, 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 and we'll grab a hold of what we see because that's the picture that's presented to us. Could it be that we forgot about our arbitrator? Could we forget? Have we forgot that there was already a prearranged arrangement for us? But because we forgot about it, we grabbed a hold of the very next convenient thing. Which brings along the wrong alignment. It has us chasing a vision, trying to build something unto our own name. How many of us have disagreed with what the Lord said about us at one point in time or another? Well, I'm going to put my hand up. Matter of fact, I'm going to raise it real high. How many of us have disagreed about what the Lord was speaking in the time that we were going through? How many of us have disagreed with what the Lord said do at an appointed time because we felt like we wasn't authorized to do it? How many of us have disagreed with connecting with someone because they didn't seem agreeable? They didn't seem like they were on our level. They didn't seem like they were according to our plan. Because we were building a city unto our name. We weren't building kingdom. We were building a city unto our name. Oh, I'm sorry. I know that might not seem so great to us and it don't sound so PC. But if your arrogant stinking tail always can find fault, but can't see fault, let alone admit fault. Watch this. And when somebody's trying to tell you about fault, you automatically got something to say without ever hearing it. Oops, let me stop. A disagreement is the fact that somebody's defending themselves against what they hear, see, or feel. That brings about disagreement. I don't agree. I don't like. I'm in conflict with. I'm in rivalry to what you are now presenting me. How can God show you if he doesn't bring you opposition. Because all you're ever going to do is believe what you see. But how do I build confidence in you? How do I build you up? How do I make you strong if I bring you no resistance? How do I break you from routine if I don't mess up your routine? How do I break you from a false confession if I never show you the truth? Because you built this city around what you want it to look like and how you want it to feel. And you agreed with this image of being grand. I'm so grandiose. I can stick my chest out because I'm proud and I want the world to see me. But even the ants have a purpose on life, in life on this earth. Maybe the ant is there to gather, and I kind of call them the trash collectors. Because the ant's going to get the little bitty stuff that didn't nobody else want, that otherwise would have been trash. Maybe you're a trash collector in the kingdom. Maybe you're not supposed to be so grandiose right now. But I want you to understand the power of the ant. The ant can pick up something three times its size. But if you notice, the ants don't roll solo. And neither did the people of Shinar. They come together in a pack because as the more of them come together, the more work they can get done. But we don't want to get work done with everybody because Western culture said, I'm the superstar. Everybody want to be like the purple one, Prince. I'm a star. You're running around with your butt cheeks out, looking like a fool. I'm sorry. Yes, you. God bless you. But the man has some very demonic tendencies. Sorry. Celebrating him. He built his own kingdom. Yes, he did things differently. I ain't got no problem with you doing them differently. I don't have to disagree with who you are. My agreement comes with who's in you. The purpose in which you're building this kingdom. Are you building it for yourself, for what you want, how you want, when you want, or are you building it for your arbitrator? Pick up where you left off.
Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. The Lord said, if as one people speaking the same language, they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them.
Read it again.
The Lord said, if as one people speaking the
same. Stop. If as what?
One people.
If as what?
One people.
Did it say one person?
One people.
People, correct?
Yep.
So my question to you is this. The Lord is speaking of a bunch of folks that's doing something wrong. But they think they're doing something right. Because that's what the world taught them. Came together. They came into agreement. They came into alignment. They came into an authority amongst one another. Arbitrating for one another. Approving of one another. Huh? Arranging something for one another. To keep themselves from being embarrassed. I'm building this tower to keep them, or for other people to see how grandiose we are, how big we are, so that when they see us, they won't come messing with us. Because if we don't build this, they gonna come and conquer us, they gonna come scatter us, they gonna come defeat us, they gonna, wait a minute, are they not speaking all the negative sides of the touch that God had already promised them? They touching with the wrong reality. Whatever you touch, you now become either agreeable or disagreeable. such a hot pot, you won't disagree about keeping your hand there. Just think about that. Touch a baby's hair. Oh, it's so real, it's so soft, and oh, it smells so good, and it's agreeable. But you get that ugly baby. I'm sorry, y'all know doggone well it's some ugly babies out here. And though they are God's creation, God made us different for a purpose. But there's some babies out here that you...
They're just not as cute as the other.
And then you touch the hair and you be like, good Lord, which one of the parents had this hair? They need to just shave their head. I'm sorry, I'm wrong for that, but... You get the picture. You get the picture. And the reason I'm saying this to you is because you can either grab a hold of that reality or you can dismiss it. And what's funny is we're quick to either grab a hold of and receive or reject something depending upon our sensory perception. How it made me feel, how it looks to me, the texture of, the smell of. Think of it this way. You ever come in contact with that one person who had BO and they didn't know they had BO and they think they smell like roses, but they really smell like boo-boo? I'm sorry, it might sound harsh, but it's real. Because you don't know their reality, their perception, what they're touching is so positive. It's so great. It's so grandiose. But let you bring that thought before them, they'll chew your head off. God knew that he couldn't send a prophet to these people. He couldn't really speak to these people because they all on the same, they got the whole same language. They speak in the same perception. But it wasn't his. They're all on the same accord. They're on one accord. They got the same mindset. But it wasn't his. They're walking united in disagreement to what God has to do. So God said, these people, one people, together under that one language, under that one mindset, can accomplish anything. Body of Christ, I pose to you, if that could happen in disagreement, what would happen if we could agree together? What could happen even in the midst of our differences? We can come under one mindset and agree. Well, Jesus said, if any two of you, you don't need a whole nation. I'm going to give you more power than that whole nation. If you can come under the authority of the agreement. Let me break an agreement down. An agreement being a covenant or a promise. A covenant is broken by death only. Promises are yes and amen. They're guaranteed. It's a contract. And anytime you're dealing with a contract, you have to understand that there are two parties involved. You go into a mortgage agreement or a lease agreement. I have some property that one person wants. In exchange, another person wants money. So both parties will receive something. Uh-oh. Did that go over your heads? In an agreement, both parties are going to receive something. It's a contract. Contracts, they normally deal with time and investment. We went over that on Wednesday. I'm investing my time and my space with you in exchange for normally either a monetary good or something later. Difference being, most people go to court to break a contract, but you can't break one with God. Imagine if you come together with you another person and y'all merge y'all spirit. The spirit and the mind of Christ together as a threefold cord. My Bible says that it can't be broken. Oh, most people use that as marriage. No, that works with anybody. See, marriage is a relationship. I want you to understand, when you enter into agreement, you now enter into a relationship. Agreements build relationship. Agreements invest time in a relationship. Agreements invest, well, you ain't willing to give somebody, but you gotta give somebody something. Mm-hmm. In a relationship. Here's the funny part. The backside of that is, the person giving now has to be ready to receive something. Oh, I'm sorry. Both parties have to be prepared to receive something, because in a relationship, there's an exchange. The problem being, many times we get into a relationship and we dominate it because we either been given or we've been taken and ain't willing to offer nothing else, because that's in our 3x3x3. So we can't enter into an agreement. What we're into is, I'm bartering from you. Let me hold something. It's not an agreement. Because my Bible says when you lend somebody something, you don't hand it as a business transaction. You don't charge them interest. I can't keep no real record of what I'm giving you. I just know I'm giving unto you because there's another piece of this cord that's going to give back to me when you can. I'm going to give a piece of me that's going to be able to give unto you later on in this threefold cord when I want to. I may not always agree with how you are right now. I might not always agree with who you are right now. But because I'm willing to touch the other side of who you are, because I'm willing to see the other side of where you demonstrate. Watch this. I can now suffer along with your stinking tail right now. I can now suffer along with your body over. Because real talk, your attitude is a little funky to me. Your disposition is a little funky to me. You think you smell like roses, but it's real funky to me. And it's funky to me because I see the other side. I see where you're supposed to be. I see where you headed. I see you on the escalator. But the problem is, you don't want the escalator. You want to stay in your funk. You don't want to rise above the funky place. You agreeable to that. You sitting in Shinar, building your own tower of Babel. Babel means to talk. Uttering absolutely nothing. How about you, when you think in the negative thought, speak in the negative thought, but the person that's seen the other side, that's willing to touch with you, here's your Babel. To Babylon about something. Uh-oh. Babylon to Babylon. You just talking and talking and talking and talking, but you ain't doing nothing.
Right, yeah.
You ain't willing to agree. I'll make it look good. I'll make it sound good. But guess what? I'm not willing to enter into a contract that say, I'm willing to see you to the end. A contract is nothing more than an agreement that says, I'll see you to the end of this time term, to the end of this season, so that you can accomplish what you started out to do. That's what an agreement is. The problem is, we don't ever want to see ourselves to the end of that term. We just want to see ourselves to the end of that situation. If any one or two of you will touch and agree. We can't build relationships because we don't want to enter into them. Mm-hmm. We want to roll solo. Mm-hmm. We want to accomplish our own feat so that we can say we did it. We don't want to share in the fact that the minister of reconciliation reconciled us back to God, God back to us, and us back to us. Because the law of Moses said, guess what? I'm going to judge you, 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 and you for every flaw and fault that you have, and I'm going to kill you off in it. Because your fault don't look like how my God looked. And catch what I just said, how my God looked. But my God might not be his God. My God might not be his God. They were all running around babbling. Because none of their gods were the same. Oh, I worship Jehovah. I know. What Jehovah? I worship Baal. Why? I worship Asherah. You got all these different gods, but guess what? They were still trying to apply the law of Moses to it. Babbling. So there was never any grace. There was always judgment. Wait a minute, is that why we go to our 3x3x3x3? But the problem is, guess what? While we're in our 3x3x3x3, we sitting in there feeling like we say so, we judging the world as well. Trying to beat the world up with what we know, but won't receive anything beyond that. See, Jesus kept talking about, take it to this person, and if they won't listen. Take it to that person, and they won't listen. The reason why Jesus was not effective in his own homeland is because, guess what? He was misunderstood. They didn't want to listen. They knew what they knew what they knew. They applied the law of Moses and were babbling about how religious they were, how good they were, how perfect they were, and all of their beautiful faults, and could never come into agreement to see the other side. All they wanted to do was, I'm right. I sure is right. Yeah, I'm right. You better believe it. I'm right. No, you ain't right. You just got a piece of it. Listen. 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 So that when something new is posed to you, maybe you can, you know what? I can see the other side of that. Let's agree. Because when you come into agreement with one thing, if you got the mind of Christ and they got the mind of Christ, iron sharpens iron. So y'all keep sharpening each other because relationship is moving. But here's the problem. I don't trust what I see. I don't trust the vision in front of me. I want what they want. I want what they got. I want to be like them, but I don't want to tell them I want to be like them. I got the same issues as they do, but I don't want to tell them that. Saints were overcome by the testimony in the blood of the Lamb. By the testimony. Well, if you jacked up and I'm jacked up and we both running around with a busted moon boot, maybe I busted one foot and you busted the other. And maybe I just take your boot and walk around with two busted boots until I can do better. Maybe I got something that you ain't got, that you need. But you so proud, you so embarrassed, you so stubborn. Oh, wait a minute. In Mark 6:4, he said, they won't receive me because of their stubbornness. You so stubborn, that one, you ain't even willing to listen to see whether or not somebody's offering. But you so stubborn that even when you do hear it, you so proud now that you won't receive the help. So you can't even come into an agreement, watch this, with the fact that you need, with the fact that you want, you still in agreement with your misery of what you ain't got. You can't even, you got so distorted in where your mindset was that you couldn't see the other side. Matter of fact, you so stubborn because you so used to the way things supposed to be or the way things have been that you don't want to see the other side. We're just talking about a little disagreement here. But what am I disagreeing with? Could you be disagreeing with the image that you are? Well, I don't like who I am. I look in the mirror quite a bit and don't like who I am. I go to bed and repent over some stuff that I ain't so proud of. But what thought process, what is the other side of, what's the greater good in it, where am I going, and how is the escalator going to take me there? Where is my escalator? Where you at, Jesus? Where you at in this situation? What you got to say about this situation? Have I got ahead of you? Am I lagging too far behind? Am I not listening to the fact that miracles are present in my midst right now? Am I not paying attention to the fact that a miracle is birthing me every moment that I breathe? Am I not even concerned with the fact that I am a miracle? And that I'm a breeder of miracles? And that the glory of the Lord walks before me, it walks behind me, it surrounds me, and it carries me wherever I go. Am I in disagreement with this? Am I so high-minded that I walk above the glory? Am I so vain that I have to stay in a place of me, mine, and I? See, I want you to understand, vanity is nothing more than the love of self. But if you can only love self, you missed everybody else. You can't come into agreement. You're now in the agreement of the devil. I watched the movie on yesterday by the name of The Devil's Advocate. And Al Pacino played the devil in this movie. And this is what he said. My favorite sin, vanity. And I'm sitting there and I'm thinking to myself, the most beautiful angel that was in heaven loved himself more than he loved God. Got cast from heaven, and wait a minute, his number one thing is, oh, he's the father of life. No, he's the father of vanity. To make you love you more than you can love him. To make you love him more than you can love your arbitrator. More than you can love the one that approves you. More than the one that will align you. Wait a minute. More than the one that's willing to agree with you. Because the devil is the author of confusion. Confusion is nothing more than a bunch of people sitting there disagreeing. That's where strife and contention comes from. What are you agreeing with? Or better yet, are you really disagreeing with your possibilities? Because anything is possible to him that believes. Are you disagreeing with the fact that I will give anything that you ask? When you can touch, I can see the other side of, and I agree with it. I ain't talking about agreeing with their funkiness. Not gonna agree with your funkiness. I don't like your funkiness. I don't wanna smell your funkiness. But I can see you with a bath. And because I'm willing to agree with your cleanliness, I'll even give you some soap. I'll give you the word and let you have some water. What? But it's up to you to listen. Watch it. Faith come by hearing, and hearing the word of God. If you never hear it, and you never listen to what you're hearing, what are you believing? I'm just talking about a little disagreement right now. See, it's a lot of disagreement in the room. It's a lot of disagreement with how I feel toward what you're saying. I don't care. I see the other side of it. Can you? Can you see the other side of where you're going? He's like a bridge over troubled waters. Can you see yourself on the other side of the troubled waters, but you sitting on the bank thinking about how you're going to get over? Catch the word, get over. Because the problem is, that's what we've been trying to do on the world. Get over. I ain't trying to get over. I'm trying to go higher. A bridge ain't built beneath. It's built above. An escalator is nothing but a bridge to the second level or to the next level. You willing to get on? All it takes is, watch this, a little walk. All it takes is baby steps. It don't take a whole lot to get on the escalator, do it? One step, baby step. But see, the baby sometimes is afraid because everything just moving so fast. Everything keep moving so fast. Well, they ain't really moving all that fast. It's a matter of your timing. It's a matter of how you can see yourself on the other side. If you see yourself struggling to get to the other side, you got to struggle. If you see yourself not maintaining the other side, you lost the other side. If you see yourself, I don't really want to do it, you ain't going to do it.
True.
I want you to understand, I'm a dreamer. I'm big with vision. The Lord works with me because I'm a seer. So I can see the other side a lot. And then I sit there like, how? Well, I'm going to sit there and keep asking questions of how, and not see myself there, and not begin to believe and agree with, that's where I'm going. It takes longer to get there. Think about it. And all you're getting, get an understanding. Well, sometimes we so busy trying to get an understanding that we left faith behind. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. If I'm trying to get an understanding, I don't have a hope in it. Catch that. And all you're getting an understanding. Get an understanding of the word. But when God gives you the vision, if you're so busy trying to understand the vision, you'll leave faith behind and you won't get there. Because you'll dawdle and how you could be embarrassed. You'll begin to create possibilities. You begin to procrastinate. You begin to fuss and complain of. You begin to put things before God. So therefore, the vision that God's putting before you, though it will come to pass, it has to lay dormant until you're fertile enough. Till you're fertile enough. Till you're fertile enough to give birth to the vision. Fertility is nothing more than agreement. It's your body agreeing with whatever sperm and egg came together. See, the sperm and egg came into relationship with one another to birth something else out. Relationships always birth something else out. It ain't just for you and them. The problem is, many times we enter into a relationship selfishly, looking for what it's going to provide me. That's a Tower of Babel. That's a Tower of Babel. again, battle is to talk, to act like you're saying something, but it means nothing. Because it only means something to you. Anybody ever babbled in their life?
Yes.
Talking and talking and talking. Ain't said nothing. And they want the world to relate to what we said, even though we know we ain't saying nothing. Knowing it ain't gonna accomplish nothing, but something to make us feel better. Watch this. You're offering something that you don't even want to receive. We just learned about the first fruits. You give the first of to God with an expectation of getting something more. Well, the second part of it is yours. The rest is yours. But when you offer what's yours to somebody else, and it ain't even what you want, and you wouldn't agree to it, 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 why would you expect them to? Mm-hmm. Well, let me use that in layman's terms. We ain't gonna call it rich dummy. We're gonna call it layman's terms today. If your negative disposition, you don't even like to hear, you've been repenting over. Your attitude, you've been repenting over. Your excuses, you've been repenting over. Your lack of, you've been repenting over. Why are you giving it to somebody else to agree with you? Watch this. If your past is something that you didn't agree with, and all you can see is your right now as a remnant of your past that you ain't even willing to go past. It's the one thing you're leaning on to hold you up. Why in the hell are you offering it to me? I don't want that crutch. I don't even want to hear about that crutch, because I'm trying to look past where you are. And you keep reminding me of where you don't want to go. And then you get mad when I'm cutting you off. You get mad when you get corrected. You get mad when it feel like the world kicks you in your hind parts. He me. He don't accept me. He always rejected me. No, nigga didn't reject you. He rejected the image that you had of you. He rejected your vision, because your vision don't line up with the mind of Christ that he gave me going that way. So no, I can't agree with you in that. That's what Matthew 18 was talking about. When you see a fault in your brother and sister, he ain't say go name everybody's issues. Mm-hmm. But if you ain't in proper alignment, and I see you falling, I see you headed down the wrong path, I see your thought process ain't quite grabbing a hold of, my job ain't to sit back and say nothing. Because I'm in relationship with you. 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 So if I'm in relationship with you, I'm accountable to you the same way you're supposed to be accountable to me. So watch this. When I can't be accountable to myself because I'm in my fifis, the one that's agreed with me, the one that can touch and agree with me, watch this, will now take me by the hand, baby. Come on. I don't want to be no baby right now. Stop disagreeing with me and hear me out. Because here's the funny part. I had this thought last night. When you were little and you got corrected by mama, mama said something to you, if you said something back, good, bad, or indifferent, you got popped in the mouth. What happened if the person that's accountable to you just start popping you in the doggone mouth every time you spoke something that was ignorant of the vision where you headed. How would you feel? You wouldn't deal with that person very long, would you? Could that be the reason why you feel so rejected? Because you stopped dealing with the person, because for real, they was popping you in the mouth in the spirit. Come on now. How many of us had smart mouths? How many of us just talk too darn much? Well, my question to you is this. Could it be that you talk too darn much now? When somebody's trying to get you steered on the right way, and here's the funny part, they really encouraging you, but you got discouraged by it because you didn't hear them. You refuse to listen. You refuse to receive their contractual point. So you was in covenant with this person, and contractually their job was to realign you, to tell you when you're wrong. You signed a lease agreement on your apartment. When you late, they, in order to correct you, they send you a letter to let you know about it. They don't cut you off immediately. They send you a letter as a reminder. How many reminders did we get that we really didn't care about? We wasn't really in agreement with. I don't want to hear that because of what I'm feeling right now. Because of what I'm doing right now. Because of what I see right now. I'm sorry, I'm in a whole different place and in a whole different zone, but I want you to understand that, see, God being in covenant with you, being his, you being his creation, he's always going to nudge you. He's always going to send somebody to you. And when he sends the confirmation, are you listening? When he sends the person to realign you, are you listening? See, the good part about relationship is you take turns leading. So you have to learn how to follow before you can take the lead. See, I had a couple of pastors that rescued me and taught me how to follow so that I could be able to lead and I can have a new direction of leading because the Lord would let me see how they led and to take from them what I needed to be me for the vision he showed me. What if you taken from other people and came into agreement and alignment with that wasn't from him? Mm-hmm. See, I don't know how you put this. Oprah, number one gossip. Dr. Phil. Dr. Phil will sit back and it's kind of funny, you know, his real name is Philip, but he play on your feelings and your emotions to get you emotionally charged to feel sorry for somebody else. And all of a sudden, you take what they got and what they've been through and you bring it into you. Agreeing, accepting, receiving. How about your girlfriends? They pass miseries and sorrows. They're real good about telling them stories. Are they not? Mm-hmm. And then we grab a hold of that. We receive what they say. We ain't in agreement with where they should be. We're just in agreement with where they are. See, oh no, the Lord said he'll meet you right where you are. Yeah, he'll meet you right where you are to touch you so you can get to the other side. He didn't touch you to sit back and say, oh boo-hoo, let me give you some tissue. Let me wipe your nose. No. That ain't the God I serve.
Yes.
Right.
And many times we waiting on somebody to touch and agree with us right where we are, but to hell with where you are, because where you are is in hell, and I ain't going there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How can you meet the next person, evangelize for that person, pray for that person, if you stuck where they stuck? Mm-hmm. Because you receive it, they stuck. Yeah, you take it in, and you say, you know what, but I know a God that can turn that thing around. Mm-hmm. Let us touch and agree to turn your mess into a possibility. The devil will provoke you and provoke you and provoke you. And what he does in this provocation, he's showing you the negative sides. Showing you the negative sides. I'm telling you, watching this movie last night or yesterday afternoon blew me away. Because Keanu Reeves is talking to the devil and he's saying, You set me up. And the devil said, no, I didn't. All I did was present a possibility to you. Mm. It was you that took it. I love this thing that God gave called free will. Because guess what? It's your free will that you surrendered for a negative outcome. Because you didn't come into agreement with what God already promised. He sat back and he began to talk about how men will build themselves and build themselves and build themselves. And all I kept hearing was Tower Babel, Tower Babel. Because all the devil was doing was babbling on, trying to talk you into his situation. How many of us have tried to talk somebody into our situation, or better yet, been sitting with somebody that talked you into theirs? They're in the middle of a dark place, but you come into the dark place and want to go sit in the darkness instead of being the light set on the hill for all men to see. What we do is we battle on. Battle on. For what? If you notice, you look at the synonyms of agreement. None of them talk about talking. Mm. Talk is cheap. What you doing? What are you willing to do? The action in prayer. The action in making an arrangement. The action of one who's authorized. If I'm authorized to do something, and I don't do it, I've dismissed my authority. I have not come into agreement with my authority. God made you an authorized agent in the earth to carry out his plan. So when I fail to do what I'm authorized to do, I don't agree with what God said about me. Am I in disagreement? I charge you today. I charge you today. If you really want to hear, remember, faith comes by hearing, right? And Jesus was talking about the folks that wouldn't listen. Start listening. Not to them, but to yourself. Listen to the words that you speak. And you'll find out whether or not you're in disagreement with your destiny. If you're in disagreement with your purpose. Watch it. If I ain't speaking nothing, but I ain't doing nothing, I'm still in disagreement. But if I'm always speaking of the negative side of the equation, and I keep seeing negative results, could it be that I'm in agreement with the curse and not the purpose? If I can quote that all things come together for the good of those who love the Lord, but then I'm always talking about what's ticking me off, what that made me mad, could it be that the Lord was working on something, but I ain't called out that he doing something better in my life? See, I was supposed to get excited, but I got pissed off. And I start babbling on about it. My Bible says that he comes back to Babylon to destroy it. Maybe he's trying to destroy your speech right now so that he can bring something better up out of it, because he's going to raise up his folk. Which means that he got to escalate your language. He got to destroy your language. They were all on one accord under one language, trying to build something for themselves. He got to destroy your language to bring you up, to touch and agree with you. How about this? He'll meet me right where I am. Well, he did. When he destroyed your language, because you got to understand, this is the law of agreement. A law is only put into establishment to judge something. Oh. Huh? Break the law and you're going to stand before what? A judge. if indeed you got to stand before a judge to even see the level of agreement that you're at. The judge brings forth a judgment to do what? To correct, not to kill. So when the judgment comes on your agreement level, and you get punished a little bit, you get corrected, you catch your sentence, don't get mad, because all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord. He chastens those whom he loves. He's doing something in his love. What are you? Can you receive it? Sorry, a contract says I gotta receive and give. I just can't receive and not give something back. Contract says there's a relationship. See, we sit back and say, oh, believe and receive. You gave your belief, so now you can receive something. But we miss the believe and receive portion of it, because real talk, we think, okay, if we just think it for the situation, we'll receive the situation. Many times that's all we get, is the situation. God's never able to give you more. You gotta understand, agreement brings forth a corporate setting. And where there's a corporate setting, there comes a corporate blessing. There's a greater blessing outside of the one that you just gave. Are we missing the corporate blessing? Because we disagree with it? Because it ain't about them? It's about me. It's about how I feel. It's about my insecurities. Are we missing the corporate blessing? Are we missing that greater blessing? How about this? Are we missing the miracle because we ain't really trying to see nobody else get one because we waiting to have one happen for us? Jesus could not perform miracles in his own hometown, in his own place, where people knew him, because they wanted what they wanted for them. They wanted what they wanted in a situation that was only going to benefit them. There was no desperation for something greater. There was nothing outside of a corporate, well, I'm sorry, a personal blessing, because guess what? Nobody wanted to work in a corporate setting. Jesus had a hard time evangelizing in his hometown. Couldn't talk to folks about God because they were serving somebody else. And babbling on about. But never came into a fullness of who they were even serving. Why? Because when God wanted to expose himself as a different type of God than what they understood, they disagreed. Nobody really knew God as a healer. That's why they couldn't get healed there. Nobody really knew him as deliverer, even though they were the nation that was delivered. But, you know, they were so displaced from deliverance that they ain't know him as deliverer. Couldn't get delivered. Didn't really know him as teacher because they had a teacher in the synagogue. So they couldn't be taught. Couldn't know him as lover because they didn't have love in their hearts. Didn't know him as savior because they didn't want to be saved. Not by what was in front of them. Because what they saw was something that couldn't save them. Could it be that the very person God's sending to you to give you a message is his saving grace? Could it be that chastisement that, hey, slow down. Could that be your saving grace? The warning that you didn't heard the car crash. And now you're looking for it because you listened. You just didn't hear it, you listened. It's now your saving grace because You get a second message that confirms what you already heard. Oh, God always confirms his word. Offer up your best. Slow down. Listen. Invest. Time. Get on the escalator. Could these be your saving grace? Could this be your catapult to the miracle that you've been praying for? That you've been looking for? That you've been sidestepping? He couldn't perform them right there because folks got so familiar with his background. They got so familiar with his personability that they couldn't see nor trust the God in him. Could this be why you disagree? Well, faith has the eyes to see God where nobody else can. Faith has the eyes to see the greater good where everybody else sees doom. Faith has the eyes to call out what people have been battling on for years. Can you agree with faith? Can you agree with love? Can you agree with the word? Can you agree with the promise? Can you agree with your purpose? Or am I in disagreement? And you can fill in the blank with what? I charge you today. Write the question down. Am I in disagreement with, and you fill in the blank? We're talking about moving in a different place, a different posture, a different tone, a different attitude, higher dimensions. Are you in disagreement with him? I just challenge you today to challenge yourself, to challenge where you are. Because many times it's so easy to see them, to see their fault. Well, I'm going to demonstrate Matthew 18 to you. Not only am I coming to you one-on-one, but I'm coming to everybody in the church together. I'm coming to you with two or three witnesses. I'm coming to you in agreement with the Father. I'm coming to you with a word from God. A question from God. Will you answer? Will you answer? That deep in the street, huh? No, that don't make you feel all that good because there's some places that you ain't really in agreement. You ain't really liking. God don't care. Can you call on the escalator in place of that? See, watch this. Wherever you fill in the blank, substitute it with Jesus because that's what you're in disagreement with. Whatever the place is, whatever the excuse is, whatever the circumstance is, substitute it with Jesus, because that's what you're in disagreement with. Jesus is the beginning and the end of all possibilities. Which ones have you passed by? Which ones have you overlooked? Which ones just ticked you off to the point where I don't want to see it? So you can't even touch it to see the other side. Let alone grab a hold of a vision that may be a bridge to it. Sharon, pray us out.
Father God, we come before your throne of grace, giving you the glory, giving you the honor, and giving you the praise. Oh God, we thank you for a new opportunity for an eyesight, oh God, to be able to walk in agreement with you, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for tugging on our hearts, oh God, and making us see ourselves for who we truly are, oh God, and knowing the destruction that we've created in our own lives, oh God. Thank you for taking us outside of the box, oh God, and bringing us closer to you, oh God. Thank you for us coming together as one, oh God, in agreement with your word, oh God. Thank you for showing us a different way. Thank you for your word being true and it being the lamplight beneath our feet, oh God. Thank you for giving us ears to listen and to truly hear, to truly acknowledge, oh God. Acknowledge your word and your desires for us, oh God, and the places that you have for us to go into, oh God. Father God, we thank you for the breaking of disagreement, oh God. We thank you for even the breaking of disagreement that exists in this church, oh God. I pray, oh God, that we stand and hold tight to your word, oh God, and that we sever broken relationships and we build new relationships, oh God, that are following your will for us together as one, so that we can go out to the world, oh God, and exemplify what you desire for us to do. We just thank you, oh God, for this very day, oh God. We thank you for this word, oh God. We thank you for it be life, for it being life-changing, oh God. And anything that we brought in here with us, oh God, that is not like you, if we have yet to surrender it, oh God, we take this time, oh God, to give it unto you, oh God. We let go of every barrier that is holding us confined to ourselves, oh God. We thank you for the destruction of our language that we use to upbuild ourselves, no matter what facet of our life is in, oh God. But we thank you for destroying that language and building us up in unity in the language that you designed for us to use for the upbuilding of your kingdom. Oh God, we just ask that we recognize who you are, oh God, that we live according to your will, oh God, that we exercise our measures of faith, oh God. You know, this morning you had me thinking about people exercising, but then we exercise our faith. When people begin to exercise, you see a difference in them physically, oh God. We pray that our exercise and our faith and our relationship with you and our love, oh God, and our peace and our understanding, oh God, builds us up so that people recognize, so that people can see the change, that we're not selfish and just want to keep it to ourselves, oh God, but that we are exemplifying what our connection, what our relationship with you can do for them, oh God. Father God, we ask that you just hold tight onto us, oh God, and keep us in the comfort of our arms. You said you'll never leave or forsake us, oh God, and we trust you for your word, oh God. We just give you the glory, we give you the honor, and we give you the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.